There's no guilt or shame for those who have been covered by the blood of Jesus. And now the words of our accuser have been robbed of. Clean, and we lift up our hands and sing. We are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. God, if you are for us, who can be against us? What can separate us from your love? Once we were the slaves and prisoners, now we're children of the King, the favored sons and daughters saved by the blood of Jesus. So tell me, death, where is your victory? And tell me, grave, where is your sting? You've been swallowed up in life forever by the blood of Jesus. We are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. God, if you are for us, who can be against us? We are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. By the word of our testimony, the enemy has been, the enemy will be defeated. By the blood of the Lamb, by the word of our testimony, the enemy has been, the enemy will be.
Hello there. Pastor Dave from Pilgrim Lutheran Brethren Church. Welcome. We're so glad you're with us today. Today's sermon is entitled More Than Conquerors. And it is the weekend of July 25th. Can you believe it's already almost August? This year's gone so fast. I don't know about you, but it's been so busy. I feel like I've been trying to pack in everything I didn't get to do in 2020 just in the first 6 months of 2021. Oh, it's been crazy. And we had the opportunity to take a vacation not too long ago. We got to go away for a week. And we asked our kids, we said, hey, where would you guys like to go? And they said, somewhere where we can just relax. And I tell you, I was right there with them. And for us in our family, if we're talking about relaxing for a vacation, it's going to be a beach trip. And so we got to go. And while we were there, I consciously made an effort to unplug. I limited my phone use to just the essentials. No social media. No mainstream media, no news. It was awesome. It was so good. I really strongly recommend, if you haven't done it lately, take a digital detox. Get away from all that stuff. It was the most relaxed I've been in a long time. But as soon as that vacation was over, You guessed it. We were right back. There was social media. There was news networks. There was newspapers. We are constantly bombarded with messages, whether we want to be or not. There is so much noise, and most of it is negative, but it's constantly coming, whether it's terrorism, politics, social issues, tragedies, or natural disasters. 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, it's coming at you. Talking heads are weighing in on what's happening in the world, and they're telling us what they think in an effort to affect the way that we think. And over the last week or so, the media has covered a lot of really disheartening news. Devastating flooding throughout Europe and Asia. Huge fires out west, so big that they're actually affecting our air quality here in northeastern Ohio. Constant political fighting and unrest. The threat of this new COVID-19 Delta variant. What is that going to mean? And all the fears that come with that. You know, just these facts alone can be hard to deal with. But you add to that all the constant opinions and coverage, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. Pile all that on top of the struggles of our personal life, and it's easy to become overwhelmed. It can feel like the whole world is out of control. It can feel like we're experiencing sadness and anger and division and depression and despair, fear and helplessness. But today, I want to offer you something very different. I want to offer you some good news. I want to offer you a message intended to overcome these negative emotions. A message from God's Word intended to build you up today. Today we'll be reading from the book of Romans, but before we do, I want to take a minute to set the stage. The book of Romans is a letter written by the Apostle Paul to a group much like ourselves. He's writing to a group of Christians in Rome in the year 57 AD. Now you see, in 57 AD, the ruler was the Roman Emperor Nero. Nero is known to have persecuted and murdered the early church and the Christians in terrible, terrible ways. And just like us, I would imagine they were experiencing fear and helplessness, defeated in their sufferings. But Paul comes to them with a message that's repeated over and over again in God's Word. He encourages the early Roman church not to be defeated by fear. Look at Romans 8:37. Paul tells the Roman Christians and us, "No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us." So I got to ask you, what is a conqueror? It's not a word we use every day. Merriam-Webster defines it as one that defeats an enemy or an opponent. When you hear that, who comes to mind? Here's my little short list. Augustus Caesar, Charlemagne, Attila the Hun, Alexander the Great, Genghis Khan. Great conquerors, right? Well, let me ask you this. Did you come to mind? That phrase, "we are more than conquerors," is really interesting. In the Greek, the entire phrase is in one word. Hooper nekomen. You see, the prefix hooper is where we get our English word hyper, which means more than, way more than, hyper. The nekao comes from the root word Nike. Maybe you're familiar with that. Maybe you've seen this logo. It means victory or to overcome, to triumph, to conquer. You put these two together and it means to thoroughly conquer, not just to win, to really win. And that men at the end, the little men at the end, that means we are. So they shove all that into one word. So hooper nekomen means we are more than conquerors. Is that how you feel today? I don't know about you, but there are plenty of days that I feel like I have been more than conquered. But God's word tells us no. No, we are, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. And in Romans chapter 8, 35 through 36, we see a list of these things, all these things that Paul's speaking about, that we are more than conquerors of. So look at Romans 8, 35 through 36. Paul asks the question, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered." Here we see Paul offers us a list of 8 things that can cause us to fear, to give us insecurity. He begins with, who shall separate? Who? That's beings. So whose? beings, trouble, hardship, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, and sword. Think about it. No matter what we face, our adversities fall under one of these categories. Can you imagine how any one of these might separate you from the love of Christ? As Americans, we tend to not worry about some of these, but others, they're not very hard to imagine. But in every case, the common denominator is the fear that they bring about. Fear has the power to paralyze us, to render us ineffective. The American writer Mark Twain, speaking of courage, is quoted as saying, "Courage is resistance to fear, mastery of fear, not the absence of fear." Scripture doesn't say that as Christians we will never have to endure any of these things. It doesn't say that we won't experience suffering. What it is saying, though, is that while we may endure these things, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors through Him, Jesus Christ, who loved us. We are more than conquerors. That tense, what tense is the word "are"? Present tense, right? Not future tense. Paul's not saying you will be conquerors. Paul's not saying, boy, hopefully you'll be conquerors. He's saying you are conquerors. The scripture, God's word, is telling us that right now we can resist fear. Because as Christians, we are more than conquerors. But how can we be so confident in this reality? Well, the first thing that we need to do is we need to ask ourselves a very important question. And that question is, do you know who you are? As Christians, we have to first recognize who we are before we can know this to be true. So let's turn back to the beginning of Romans 8. Let's look at Romans 8, verses 1 through 4. Paul begins by making this incredible declaration. Listen, "Therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so He condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Because of our sin, each of us had a price on our head, a bounty, and that price was death. So God paid the ransom of death for you and for me when Jesus died on that cross. God sacrificed His one and only Son to do what we and the law cannot do, to pay that debt of death. And when we believe that to be true, when we believe Jesus died for our sins, we are set free. You are set free. Praise God, isn't that awesome? And because of that, we live in the Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives us the ability to no longer fear what the flesh fears. Now let's skip ahead. Let's look at Romans 8, verses 11 through 17. "And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you." Take a second to process that. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, lives in me. Verse 12, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live." Now, this next portion is one of my favorite scriptures, so listen close. Romans 8, 14 through 16. "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves, so that you will live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, 'Abba, Father.' The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." When we receive the Spirit of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we are adopted. Now, have you been adopted? I mean, in a real sense, in our world today, were you adopted? Or maybe as a parent, have you adopted a child? If you've never experienced adoption, this word may not seem like very much. But let me share with you my story of adoption. You see, when I was born, my mom was a teenage unwed mother. And until just a few years ago, I didn't know my father. But when I was 4 years old, my mom met and married a great man. His name was Doug Martin. He eventually would become my dad. And I use that term dad very specifically. You see, I'm a firm believer that any man can become a father, but it takes a very special man to be a dad. A dad is a man who knows that love is an action. Dad is a term of affection. It's like Papa or like Abba, like we heard in our scripture. It's a very special, special man. It's a man who loves his children more than himself. That's a dad. Well, I remember, again, being 4 years old. I was even shorter than I am now. My dad was very tall. And we walked into the courthouse, and we walked up to the judge, and the judge was sitting at the bench. And to me, it was like the image in that scene from Wizard of Oz. Just huge man. And there was a formal ceremony, like a wedding. And I remember that judge asking if we wanted to be father and son. And I remember my dad saying that he wanted me. He wanted to be my dad. I was the child of another man, but my dad adopted me. And he loved me as if I were his own till the day that he died. That's what it means to be adopted. And that's what God did for you. That's what this scripture is telling us God did for you. Look at verse 16. God says that you and I are his children. As Christians, we've been adopted. We are children of another, but now we are his. So let me ask you that question again. Do you know who you are? Well, the scripture tells us you're no longer a slave to sin. You've been set free, and the Spirit of Christ lives in you. But maybe a better question would be, do you know whose you are? You are the adopted child of God with the ability to call him dad. And that's the gospel truth. Doesn't that sound good, to be a child of God? Well, this next verse may be a little tough to swallow after that. Let's look at Romans 8, verse 17. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. Have you ever endured something so difficult, so just excruciating, and thought, why am I suffering this? Why me, God? Why is God letting this happen to me? During one of the darkest points in my life, I heard a sermon that pointed to this very scripture. And through scriptures like this, and through others, and through time, and spending time, and asking questions of God, God gave me a new perspective. Ultimately, I found myself asking, if Christ had to suffer and die so that I could live, then what might God be doing in the midst of my suffering now? Looking back, I can see many, many ways that God blessed others through my suffering. But I couldn't see it then. Let's jump over to Romans 8, 28 through 30. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. So, when we suffer trials and tribulations, violence, illness, sadness, loneliness, is God doing that for my own good? Is that what we think Christ did? Do we think that Christ suffered for his own good? No, he suffered and died and was raised to life for those who love him so that we could have eternal life. Each of us has a story, a testimony of how we came to faith, how we came to Christ, and how our faith has been strengthened through these difficult times we've endured. But we probably don't think very much about the story of others, how others have suffered so that we could come to faith. Along with Christ, many others have shared in the suffering so that you and I could be called children of God. Parents, let me ask you, would it ever be your will that one of your children would suffer? I would hope that we would all say no, by no means. But let me offer you a scenario. Bone marrow transplants, they are incredibly painful. but often they are the definitive treatment for diseases like leukemia. And most of the time, a sibling is the best donor. If one of our children was diagnosed with leukemia, would it be wrong to allow one child to suffer pain in the means of a bone marrow transplant so that another might live? Well, is it wrong for God to allow one of his children to experience some suffering if through that suffering another child might find eternal life? When I experience suffering now, I always try to remember to ask myself, if Jesus had to suffer and die so that I could live, how can whatever I'm enduring help someone else? I may never know, but I can trust that God's using it. Verse 29 says that we are to be conformed to the image of his son. One image that I think of when I think of his son and I think of suffering, I imagine the image of Jesus sitting in the Garden of Gethsemane, praying by the moonlight, in anguish as he prepared to suffer, to go to the cross, to be crucified for our sins. But you know another image that I have? I have another image of Jesus sitting triumphantly at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And Jesus sat down because the work of salvation was done. The scripture is clear what this means for us. Because Jesus conquered sin and death, we are more than conquerors. Let's keep reading. Look at verses 31 through 34. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? If God is for us, who can be against us? What a great statement. But who is this us that Paul is speaking to? He's speaking to you and me and Paul himself and the early Christians in Rome. He's speaking to all the Christians who came before us and all the Christians who will come after us. If God is for you, who can be against you? Look at verse 33. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. There it is. Another present tense word, is. I think many times this important fact is forgotten. Our God is a living God. Yes, Jesus died for our sins, but he was also raised to life, and he is seated at the right hand of God the Father. And he intercedes for us. He pleads our case. Do you know what that word justifies mean? That's not a word we use every day. Justifies. It's a legal term. It means to be declared righteous in God's sight. Jan once taught me, justified, just as if I'd never sinned. That's what it means to be justified. And because Jesus has been glorified, the victory is already his. And because Jesus is God, his spirit is the one that lives in us. That means he's not far off. He's involved in our every single day life. There's nothing we experience that he doesn't know. And because of this, the victory is already ours before the battle's even fought. Whatever your sufferings might be, if God is for us, who can be against us? Well, maybe you're like me. Maybe you're thinking, if anybody can mess up this deal, it's going to be me. Well, what if I messed this up? I want you to hear some words from Jesus Christ. Turn with me to John 10, verses 27 through 30. Jesus says, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. Let me ask you, do you hear his voice? God offers eternal security. He offers us eternal life. Not conditional life, not as long as you make God happy life, eternal life, that you shall never perish. Have you ever imagined yourself being held securely in the hand of God himself? That's what Jesus is saying. We should claim this. I pray that you can claim this. Let's go back to Romans 8, 35 through 39, and let's put it all together. Romans 8, 35 through 39. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Simply put, nothing can separate us from the love of God. So let me ask you one more time. Do you know who you are? If you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and the work that he did on the cross for the salvation of your sins, God's word gives us the answer. Let's start with who you're not. You are no longer a slave to sin. You are not controlled by sinful nature, and you are not a child of Satan. But who you are free. You are controlled by the Spirit of Christ who lives in you. You are a child of God and a co-heir with Christ. You are justified. You are glorified. You are eternally secure. And you are more than conquerors. If you don't think that you can claim that truth, if you're struggling with that, please come see me, come see Pastor Bob, one of the elders, or somebody else in the church that you trust. God is speaking to you, and he wants to claim you as his son. He wants to claim you as his daughter. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. Lord, we hear your word. And Father, we are so grateful to be your sons and daughters, to be adopted, Lord. And Lord, we know that in all things, we are more than conquerors, Lord. But we pray that your word will feed our hearts. Give us the strength to defend against fear. And Lord, we pray that those who are being called, Lord, they would respond. They would believe that you have saved them from their sins. We pray all these things in your heavenly name. Amen.
I was there.